Before pathology, we have to recall the major concepts in physiology of cardiac muscle. When neural stimulus reach sarcolemma of cardiomyocytes, it causes local depolarization of the cellular membrane. Local depolarization causes activation of voltage-gated sodium channels. And with activation, sodium channels open, and because sodium is extracellular ion, by concentration gradient, sodium is going into the cell. Increasing intracellular sodium level causes activation of dehydropyridine receptors that are located on the cellular membrane. Actually, dehydropyridine receptors are L-type calcium channels. And with activation, calcium channels open, and because calcium is extracellular ion, by concentration gradient, calcium is going into the cell. Increasing intracellular calcium level induces activation of ryanodine channels that are located on sarcoplasmic reticulum. With activation, ryanodine channels open, and calcium that is stored in sarcoplasmic reticulum by concentration gradient is going into the cytosol. This causes a significant increase in intracellular calcium level, and calcium massively binds to troponin and induces contraction. To explain how contraction occurs, there is actin molecule and there are myosin molecules, and there are binding sites on actin molecule. But in relaxed state, binding sites are covered by tropomyosin. So basically, in resting state, tropomyosin do not permit myosin to bind to actin binding sites. But there is such molecule as troponin. Troponin regulates tropomyosin conformation, and the only thing that affects troponin is calcium. If calcium level in the cytosol is low, troponin do not induce any changes in tropomyosin molecule. But if only calcium level in the cytosol sufficiently increase, troponin binds calcium and induce conformational changes in tropomyosin. These changes basically expose the binding sites on actin molecule. So now myosin can bind to actin with formation of so-called actin-myosin bond. These bonds will create a peak muscle tension and this results in contraction. And very important to understand that the higher the calcium concentration in the cytosol, the more calcium will bind to troponin, thereby the stronger troponin will affect tropomyosin conformation. The more binding sites will be exposed, so the more myosin molecules will bind to actin, so the higher will be the number of actin-myosin bonds. And this results in the higher force of contraction. And in normal conditions, this positive inotropic effect helps heart to pump the blood. After contraction, relaxation has to occur. To relax, calcium level in the cytosol has to decrease. And decrease in calcium occurs by sodium-calcium exchanger and by sarcoprotein. Sodium-calcium exchanger is located on the cellular membrane. And the specific feature of sodium-calcium exchanger is that it can work in two modes. In so-called forward mode, sodium-calcium exchanger transports sodium into the cell and calcium out of the cell. In reverse mode, sodium-calcium exchanger transports sodium out of the cell and calcium into the cell. It all depends on intracellular sodium level. Low intracellular sodium level induces forward mode, and high intracellular sodium level induces reverse mode. So to decrease calcium level inside the cell, sodium-calcium exchanger has to work in a forward mode. And because sodium inhibits forward mode on sodium-calcium exchanger, forward mode can be induced only by decreasing intracellular sodium level. Intracellular sodium level is regulated by sodium-potassium ATPase. Sodium-potassium ATPase is located on the cellular membrane and provides transport of sodium out of the cell and potassium into the cell. Because sodium is extracellular ion and potassium is intracellular ion, this transportation occurs against concentration gradients. And any transportation against concentration gradient requires energy in form of ATP molecule. So sodium-potassium ATPase use cell energy reserves and pumps out sodium molecules in exchange for potassium molecules. This causes decrease in intracellular sodium level, and low intracellular sodium level induce forward mode on sodium-calcium exchanger that provides export of one calcium molecule out of the cell and transports three sodium molecules into the cell, and by this intracellular calcium level decrease. And also decreasing intracellular calcium level is provided by a sarcoprotein. Sarcoprotein located on sarcoplasmic reticulum, and this protein provides transportation of calcium into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And because in this case transportation occurs against concentration gradient, the activity of this pump requires energy in form of ATP molecule. So sarcoprotein uses cellular energy reserves and pumps calcium back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Obviously, this could decrease in intracellular calcium level, and decreasing intracellular calcium level provides relaxation of the cardiomyocyte. So the most important concept here, for cardiomyocytes, it's an absolutely vital to produce enough energy to maintain the function of sodium potassium ATPase and sarcoprotein, because otherwise the level of calcium inside the cell will be extremely high. So how cardiomyocytes produce energy? One of the major sources of energy for cardiac tissue is glucose. When glucose enters into the cell, glucose undergoes glycolysis. Recall that in glycolysis, glucose step by step is degraded to pyruvate. Initially, glucose is phosphorylated to glucose 6-phosphate, then glucose 6-phosphate is converted into fructose 6-phosphate, then phosphorylation occurs that results in production of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and then fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is cleaved into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dehydroxyacetone phosphate. Then dehydroxyacetone phosphate is converted to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, and the crucial moment here is that glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized by glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase that use NAD as cofactor to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. And this reaction results in formation of NADH. And if cell at this particular moment has enough amount of oxygen, then NADH is going to mitochondria where it delivers two electrons to electron transport chain, because electron transport chain is working only in aerobic condition. And electrons in electron transport chain undergo oxidative phosphorylation that results in energy production. When NADH gives two electrons, it gets converted back to NAD, and now glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase can use again this electron carrier in oxidative reaction. So it's very important to maintain this recycling of NADH to NAD to keep glycolysis going. And during glycolysis, 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate through two consecutive reactions is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate. And then phosphoenol pyruvate is converted to pyruvate, which is the final product of glycolysis. And with sufficient amount of oxygen, usually pyruvate is converted into acetyl-CoA that goes into the Krebs cycle. In the Krebs cycle, NAD and FAD molecules pluck out electrons out of acetyl-CoA with formation of NADH and FADH molecules. And then these electron carriers deliver electrons to electron transport chain that results in energy production. Also, we have to know how electron transport chain produce energy and why electron transport chain cannot function without oxygen. So its mitochondrial outer membrane, its inner membrane, and its intramembrane space. On inner mitochondrial membrane located electron transport chain that is composed of four protein complexes and coenzyme Q. And also there is fifth complex called ATP synthase that has its own unique function. The general concept here is that protein complexes in electron transport chain use energy that is contained in electron to drive hydrogen protons from mitochondrial matrix to intramembrane space. And by this electron transportation from one complex to another, complexes generate energy. 50% of this energy used to drive hydrogen protons from mitochondrial matrix into the intramembrane space, and 50% of energy generated is heat. This hydrogen movement occurs at the level of complex 1, 3, and 4. The major idea of this hydrogen transport is to lower protein concentration in mitochondrial matrix and to increase hydrogen proton concentration in intramembrane space. This process results in creation of hydrogen proton concentration gradient through inner mitochondrial membrane. With high hydrogen concentration in intramembrane space and lower concentration in mitochondrial matrix, and ATP synthase uses concentration gradient, and by transportation of hydrogen protons by concentration gradient into the mitochondrial matrix, it generates energy. And ATP synthase uses this energy for phosphorylation of ADP that results in production of ATP molecules. So proton complexes suck the energy out of electrons one after another until electrons will be completely energy depleted. And very important that after complex 4 sucks the last portion of energy out of electron, now electron has no energy inside. Such electron is a wasted material, and complex 4 throw out this low energy electron from electron transport chain to oxygen inside the mitochondrial matrix. And electrons bind to oxygen and reduce oxygen with formation of water molecules. But electron transport chain is not perfect, and small amount of electrons can leak out of electron transport chain, and in this situation they reduce oxygen in another fashion. They reduce oxygen with formation of superoxide, which is a reactive oxygen species and it's very dangerous substance. Also, we have to know that electrons are delivered to electron transport chain by mobile electron transporters as NADH and FADH. Recall that, for example, in Krebs cycle, acetyl-CoA is systematically degraded by the enzymes that are called dehydrogenases. These enzymes have NAD and FAD molecules as cofactors, so while enzymes degrade acetyl-CoA, NAD and FAD molecules takes out electrons from acetyl-CoA, each of them can pick up 2 electrons, and important that it's high-energy electrons that are completely filled with energy. And recall that in glycolysis, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase also generates NADH. So electron transporters pick up electrons from glycolysis and Krebs cycle and transport them to electron transport chain. So there are 2 important concepts. First of all, electron transport chain cannot function without oxygen, because without oxygen, complex 4 cannot get rid of wasted electrons. And while electrons are still in electron transport chain, complexes cannot intake new electrons from NADH and FADH electron transporters. So the entire chain becomes stuck. That's why it's impossible for electron transport chain to function in anaerobic condition. And the second concept is that the activity of electron transport chain results in formation of reactive oxygen species. In normal condition, only a small amount of reactive oxygen species produced. But the higher the activity of electron transport chain, basically the higher the rate of electron transportation, the more electrons leak out of electron transport chain, the more reactive oxygen species produced. So the higher will be the activity of electron transport chain, the more reactive oxygen species will be produced. Also important that cardiomyocytes are able to regulate pH inside the cell. pH regulation provided by sodium-hydrogen exchanger. This exchanger located on the sarcolemma, and sodium-hydrogen exchanger regulates intracellular pH by transportation of hydrogen molecules out of the cell and sodium molecules into the cell. So basically, this exchanger makes intracellular pH more alkaline. But also important that the activity of this exchanger causes increase in intracellular sodium levels.